All right. Good morning, everybody. My name is Tom Burgmans. I'm the technology product owner in the Wolters Kluwer. I'm leading a team, Search Center of Excellence, and we are building a technology stack that serves search in various products, online products from Wolters Kluwer. So Wolters Kluwer is a company that sells information in the domains of legal, tax, regulatory, and healthcare. And here are some examples of products that are online products. And search is a very important aspect, if not the most important feature inside many of those products. So you see the search box is very prominent there present. And product owners from those products, they often talk to each other and talk to us about how to improve search. And many times, the topic personalized search is being set as the next level of bringing search to the next level. So, but it's also controversial. So personalized search is often misunderstood. It is also an umbrella concept, which could mean very different things. It's also hard to make a case whether it is actually really useful, yes or no. And we often find myself in discussions where there was no clear consensus about what actually means personalization, how to implement it, and how to measure it. And so we, as a Search Center of Excellence, needed to come up with a voice with participate in this discussion from a standpoint of experience and knowledge, and not just another voice. So we felt we need to own this topic and actually create an implementation or a POC to just put a couple of those arguments to rest. So please join me in the journey that we went through in order to discover this. And it started with going to the theory. Just look what it means. What is personalization? What do we think that personalization means? So if you just go to Wikipedia, there's a pretty good definition, if you ask me, what the essence of personalization really is, personalized search. So it is all about capturing the user's interest and inject that in the query that the user makes. That's basically what this definition says. So the user's interest, that's the keyword here. We want to be able to capture that. So what can you do in order to capture that interest? Here we have user makes a query. What can we do? What do we know about this user in order to infer the interest of this user? So there are a couple of things that you can think about. The user is a social being, has friends, makes connections, and exchange information with others. User also has a context. It is at a certain place, uses a machine, is on a certain time, and even the weather, you can think about that as context. User is part of demographic, like for example, nationality, gender, age, profession. And the user did things in the past, so there's activity. And now that is the thing that we are going to focus on this POC, because everything else is also interesting, but it was a bit too much, at least for our exercise. So we focused on this piece also because this information was actually really available. So we had to narrow the scope a bit, but that itself didn't make it less interesting to go to this journey. So activity it is. So with that activity, this was the hypothesis that we went with. So to create a personalized search, what we need to do is build a recommendation engine, which is based on an index of user activity. And with that, we can infer the user's interest and use a technique called collaborative filtering. So how does that work? Pretty simple. If we have a user that has an interest in a couple of items, we find a user that has similar interests, and then we use the interest of that user. The other interest is then the recommendation for the first user. So pretty simple if you look at this. This is actually also how things on Netflix and Amazon, Spotify, that's basically the same principle. It's not just that simple, because as it appears to be that everybody seems to like ice cream. So the fact that something is popular does not mean it's a good recommendation. Because if that was true, then it doesn't matter which songs you listen to. You always got the same songs recommended to you. And I don't think that Netflix would make a lot of profit if you always get the same movies recommended to you, no matter what you watch. So the fact that something is popular does not make it a good recommendation, and certainly doesn't make it very personal. So what we need to do is not to find the most popular one, but the items that is best represented by the users that are very similar. So it's a bit a different expectation what we have, and to demonstrate it here in the following graph. So we have this user has an interest, and we need to find items that are unusually high present in the users that have similar interests. So we know ice cream is there because it's popular, but what is actually really interested is this cinnamon ingredient, which appears to be unusually often present in people that also like apples and tea. So this is the thing that we need to do, and what we actually, the technique that we are after, that I would like to have, is anomaly detection. So that's actually the, well, we need to find a good technology that is able to do this. Okay, so the other challenge that we thought we need to solve is if you are able to grab a set of similar users based on interest, then how do you make sure that this group, this foreground group here, is only very similar, contain only very similar users and not just a long tail of users that are just slightly similar. Why is that important? Because if you do anomaly detection on a big group of users that are both very similar and not so similar, then you get still a lot of noise back. I don't think it's very interesting to look at anomalies that happens in this section here. So we need to have a technology that is able to make the correct cutoff to only isolate the very similar users and to get rid of the long tail of not so similar users. Going on. So the next challenge. What is the ideal time window to infer the user's interest? I created a couple of users here that have a year interest in some color. So the first user here has an interest in the color red consistently and pretty frequently reddish, right, through the year. So you could basically argue that, okay, if you look back for this user for the whole year, you can say basically this the user is interested consistently in red. The second user, however, has interest in all kinds of things through the year, and even switches interest on the same day. So for this user here, it's much harder to just look back the whole year to see what is the interest of the user. I mean, it's everywhere. User number three has particular interest in color green the first part of the year, but then switches and also is not so frequent anymore. The fourth user is just very infrequent, and we have many of those. And the fifth user likes the color blue here in the beginning of the year, then works on different case here, and then works on different case there. So the whole year itself does not really tell also very articulated what the particular interest was. So so these are just illustrations, but explains a bit that we don't think that just looking back at the whole history of a year just always works for every user. This is the classical way of thinking about the personalization is to look back at the whole year of history, but we think that's not really true, always. So we thought, okay, let's also look at other use cases. For example, let's zoom in on a day, or maybe on a session. What is a session? That's kind of arbitrary. What we choose is, okay, session means a burst of activity of a user which is surrounded by a pause that is bigger than 30 minutes. And then that determines a session. So if you zoom in on this time window, then the interest is much more clear. It's like if you zoom in on a picture, and then one particular color also is going to dominate. So session-based personalization, is that possible? So yeah, I mean, we are still thinking here and brainstorming. So we also went with both of those scenarios and took it even a bit more to the extreme. Can we even do personalization if we only have a last couple of actions? Just a very tiny little bit of information. Maybe that's also already good enough in order to do some personalization on it. It will be temporarily personalization, extremely temporarily, but it's still personalization. And to demonstrate that such a thing exists, here is a Google. If you use autocomplete in Google, I type LUC, I get my autocompletions. Then I'm doing a search, which is clearly Beatles related. And then I type LUC again. And look what happens. I suddenly get beetle items in my autocomplete. Then I'm doing a following action. I'm typing solar. Type LUC again, and then I see suddenly Lucene-related items in my autocomplete. So this is really temporarily extremely tight, but still personalization. So it's one of those examples where I believe we can also make use of that. Okay, so let's imagine we are able to build a recommendation engine, and what can you do with this? Here we have a couple of scenarios. We can use personalization, the recommendations that come out of this engine, in order to boost the next query, or to filter the next query. We can also just present it as a separate result set, you know, next to the original one, or even push it to the user without him even doing a query, like when starting up a product, just display the items that this user might be interested in, or coming to the user as alerts, like via emails. And what I said before, like demonstrated by the example from Google, it can even be part of the autocomplete. So a couple of use cases. I leave in the middle what is actually, that's up to the each product owner and each business what to do with it. But the basis is we have to create a recommendation engine, spitting out recommendations. So let's build it. So the goal of this POC is to figure out how to create it and which technology we need, in which cases does it work, in which cases not. We'd like to get more clear about that as well. What data is needed in order to create this, and in the end also, very important, how to measure success. And that we're going to inject in the discussion, and then we have a better understanding. So how to build it? I had already a good feeling that we probably going to use a search engine that we know, which is probably capable of doing this. So when I start searching for a search engine that were able to do anomaly detection, Elasticsearch came up as the first candidate. It has a very good, elegant algorithm, I must say. It is the JLH score. It's very well documented. And if I'm able to select a group of similar users, it can apply this the JLH score to find anomalies. And if you plot this graph, I did it in Excel, you get a picture like this. So how it works is that if there are items in the foreground set here, very much present, then the score gets high, but only in case those same items are not so much present in the background. So this is the background, this is the foreground. So by just looking at this picture here, I can clearly understand, okay, this is really a good anomaly detection algorithm here. So Elasticsearch is probably a good candidate to do this. Just in our case, we are more a solar technology team. So we have embraced solar already. And wouldn't it be nice if solar was also able to do the same thing? So fortunately, solar also has a feature called significant terms. Isn't that great? So it's called the same. And if you look at the documentation, it clearly looks like if you read the text, OK, it's also about anomaly detection. And it's probably working fine. So I went into the code to just see what is the actual algorithm behind it. And I like always to visualize things. So I'm going to plot it as well. And then you get this weird shape of, I don't know what it is. But what I don't understand is how this can be anomaly detection. So this is not clearly the same as what Elastic has. It looks like it serves a different purpose. I'm not clearly sure yet what it is. But I think it is more like rewarding rare items in a foreground set rather than items that clearly determine the importance of that foreground set. So it's not, I was less and less convinced that this is actually really useful. Also, this is, by the way, a streaming expression, and it's also this obscure corner of solar that deserves a bit of a learning curve. So got a bit disappointed. This is probably not going to work for us. And almost gave up on solar until I did find out there is something else in solar. It's called the relatedness JSON facet, which is actually what Trey Granger told about three conferences ago, I think in the same room as here. He told about semantic knowledge graph. Now, that lives currently in solar as the relatedness JSON facet. And it is actually exactly what we need. It has also a score. So we see it here. This is algorithm. Inside, I found it inside the relatedness. AGG.java. So it is also able to detect anomalies. And if you plot this graph, you get something similar as what we have in Elastic. There's even this negative score for items that are very much unrelated. Not sure how useful that is. But it's this part of the formula that is really interesting and very much looks similar to what Elastic has. So going back here, you can see it is quite similar. So thank you, Trey Granger. I think this is really going to help us. And we could use SODA for the same purpose. OK, so the next challenge is to just isolate the very similar users. Finding similar users given a user, we could use more like this query parser for this. It's just that more like this query parser just returns everything that is very much related and also slightly related. So it has this long tail. There's just no way to cut it off at some point. So we created a plugin that is wrapping the more like this query parser in its own query parser, called it more like this plus, injected a couple of more parameters, which allows us to really cut off and tune also this part here to only isolate very similar users. So that problem was also tackled. We were ready to build it. So here we have a bunch of data coming from the data warehouse where all the user statistics are stored. Now this document is containing the history of a particular user for the whole year. All the documents that the user clicked on. Now, a click does not always mean the user likes this document, but we took a shortcut and just took all the clicks. It can also be that this user is disappointed and leaves the document quickly. But in this case, we didn't look at the amount of time the user looked at the document. We just took all the clicks. There are also some stronger signals. User can favorite a document, print it, download it, email it, or even putting labels to it. So those are stronger signals that a user has an interest in the document. So we also took those. A user has done some queries, applied filters, and all of this is one single document. So it contains the year history of a user, and we put that in Solr. So we had about 88,000 users in Solr, which we can compare to each other. I told you about those sessions. We also created from the same data, just those sessions. Each session is its own document. So we are able to compare document user sessions to each other. And have just another index here where we have about 2.5 million sessions inside Solr. And from this is kind of the basis for a recommendation engine. And created a shell around Solr, those two indexes, which we call personalization servers. And it's able to support the four use cases that that are here. So given the last year of a history, please give me recommendations. Given the last session, please give me recommendations. Given the last couple of actions, those very tiny bit of information. And the fourth one is there is a feature inside one of the products that we have where you can store very interesting documents inside a folder. So a user can do this. And we can just take the content of this folder and also to generate recommendations. So recommendations usually means these are interesting documents, interesting publications, interesting practice areas, types, and even queries. So I'm going to demonstrate this in a second. Just one couple of words about the need for personalization. And we were not that convinced that everybody needs personalization in the first place. We had a data analyst looking at the usage data to see if we can make a case where it works and where it doesn't work. Here, this is a picture that is trying to make this clear for personalization based on the complete year of history. And then selected those items that those users that are a bit more active than usual. And well, a bit more active. 20 actions a year is already active. Right, so we have only 32% of users that do more than 20 actions in a year, which is small. Right, and then from those 32% of users, there is 66% have a relatively consistent document view for the on the same two practice areas. So we can say for those 66%, the same practice areas always come back. And so in total, 21% of those users, we believe, just looking at the interest in practice areas, we can make a case, okay, for them, we may use a year-based history for as a basis for personalization. So the trick will be to isolate those users and to find a way on how to personalize items for them. So yeah, it's one way of looking at this. This is not done, this research. It's just one, let's say, dimension in which we studied this, but there are, of course, more studies needed in order to make a stronger case. And this picture tries to zoom in on how much is there actually need to do personalization based on the last session. Here we have 42% of users have a co-seen overlap between the last action, session and the current session. And the co-seen overlap is measured in the actual interest in this practice area of what the user is busy with. Okay, 42%. This 42% grows bigger if the time between the sessions is shorter, which makes a bit sense. So I can imagine that if you have two sessions on a day that and you work on a case, that the, maybe you work on the same case on that day. But if the session was last week and now we're doing a next one, maybe your the interest has been switched then. So, okay, we can say, okay, there may be some moderate interest as well to look on the previous session and use that as a prediction for the interest of the current session. So this is a difficult one. How to measure success? Offline testing, we thought about this. We can, of course, use human experts in order to determine whether the recommendations actually make sense. But this is difficult because this person has to envision what the user really needs and really wants. So you have always this bias of the interest that the domain expert has himself or herself. We had this data analyst come with an idea to build a model to predict the likelihood that the previous session predicts the interest of the current one. So there's two times predict in the sentence. Make a prediction if a prediction works. So, okay, it may work, it just, it can be very tricky in order to build it as well. So I'm looking forward to see what comes out of this, but seeing is believing here. Maybe we can use the session information that we had also to guesstimate whether predictions make sense. So there's a way to figure out how much shorter a session could have been in case personalization would have been applied. Does it work? I'm not really sure, but that's also one idea that we try to work out. And of course, we can expose a personalization and then see just how users react. But this is also tricky because you don't want to mess up the trust that users have in our products. So we have to be very careful with that. So take away from this slide, it's just very hard. And I'm looking forward after the session if you have good ideas in order to discuss this. How can we test personalization? Because working with judgment sets like we used to do, that's not going to work in this case. Okay, lessons learned. Yes, we are. It's possible to do so. We can do it. It's challenging. It works probably better for at least better testable in case of short-term personalization rather than long-term. We need quality logs, we need quality input. The better the quality of the logs is, the better the recommendations will be. And we are just starting up. So we are not done, we have a lot of ideas in order to improve this. Okay, I'm gonna skip through this because I like to go to the actual demo because does it really work? And I must say this demo is in Dutch. This is unfortunate. I try to translate as good as I can. We started with the Dutch product because that business unit appeared to be most interested in personalization. And the data was best available to us. So
I'd like to show you the personalization service, and I'm going to use a very simple application for this. You see on the screen on the left side, there's a search box which connects to a Dutch Wolters Kluwer product called Navigator. And I will do my best to translate it because it's in Dutch. And basically what it does is you can run queries and you view search results. That's all it can do. And on the right side, you see a little box that collects all the actions which I will do. And that itself will be the input for the personalization service, or also called recommendation service. So the first scenario that I'm going to demonstrate is to start from scratch. I'm just going to run some queries and collect some information, which is very small. But even with that small amount of information, I can already show that we can generate recommendations. So I'm going to search with onrechtmatige daad, which is unlawful act. And let's press search, and it will return search results. And you can also see that the query that I just executed appears on the in the box of queries on the right side. And I'm going to view a couple of documents. This document selection means I viewed a document. So viewing four documents here, and you see all the doc IDs that I just viewed are appearing in the document box. So this is a little bit of information that can already tell something about my current interest. And with that information, I could use that as input for the recommendation service. So when I press this button, it will make a call to the recommendation service, which returns recommendations. And recommendations are interesting documents that are related to the action that I just did. Also related queries and related metadata that is also being stored inside the recommendation service, such as publications, information types, practice areas. And all of this can be interested for the user, right? And we could just show it here on the right side as potential interested items. But as I said in the presentation, it could also be used for other reasons like auto completion, for boosting, for filtering. So there is a multitude of options that could be used for recommendations. Okay, but it doesn't stop here. Maybe I'd like to continue my exercise and my research, and I'd like to search with another query which is related. For example, schadevergoeding, which means compensation. Let's do a search again. And as you can see, also my query here appears next to the previous query inside the query box. I got new results in between. And let's also view some documents here. So I'm going to view this, scroll down, click another one. See my amount of documents that I've been viewing is growing because of this. It also contains the previous document views as well. I can press recommend. And now the recommendations come back is a combination of all the actions that I did before. And these are related to both onrechtmatige daad and schadevergoeding. And I could even go on and make my research even more precise. Maybe I want to search for murder, which is related to my previous two queries. View yet a couple of other documents, press recommend, and now I get a set of recommendations which is relatable to the first three queries and the document views that I did. So with all of this, I'm expressing more of my interest, and with that, I'm also focusing on the actual issue that I'd like to discover, and therefore also the recommendations that are returned are more precise. So that's the first use case. The other use case I'd like to show is that instead of just looking at the last actions, it's also possible to look at a longer time window. For example, we can look at the complete year of somebody's usage and use that as input for the recommendation engine. So let's demonstrate that. So we have indexed for each user from Navigator the complete year of 2020 as input. All the actions from each user is recorded there. It's anonymized, of course, but it contains all the information that the user did. So we can just use that as input. So going to demonstrate that with the ID that we have connected to this profile of the user. And we know from this user that it's most likely a tax lawyer that worked on various cases, on family law, on criminal law. But we also know that this user most likely had a lot of different interests through the year. And this all is now combined, and we can generate recommendations on that. And we can also already see what the actual problem is here with verifying whether this makes really sense, because you have most likely have to be this user to be the best judge in order to find out whether this is useful or not. Because I'm not this user, so it's harder for me to verify. Well, is this really something that this user would really help? So we can only guess in this case. So with that, I'd like to make the case that the longer the window is of somebody's usage, the more difficult it will be to actually verify whether the recommendations make sense. It's slightly easier if you look at a shorter time window, like a session of a user. And a session is, in this case, defined as a burst of activity which is surrounded by pauses that are longer than 30 seconds. If you just look at a particular session of a user, it's a bit easier to just see, okay, apparently this user is interested in a certain topic. For example, we have here a session which is clearly about personal injury. And I can also demonstrate that. So it's a session here. It has a session ID, which I copy-pasted in the docs. And I press the button for sessions. And the recommendations that are returned are the are items that are clearly related to personal injury. If you know Dutch, you can see that it actually makes sense that these things, these documents and these queries, and even these relatable metadata are some way in the same a similar interest as personal injury. And the last use case that I'd like to demonstrate is that a lot of our Wolters Kluwer products also have the options to create folders and to store documents in those folders. And that's what I'd like to show here. So the Navigator product has also folders options. So I created a couple of those folders and I stored documents inside those folders. The documents that are stored inside, I've been copied them from the Teams page. So what is this Teams page? It is a page where several experts created a piece of documentation around a certain team and also assembled the most relevant documents for that team, which are present on this product. So here we have a couple of teams. Just to show one, this is an expert that created a piece of documentation, which is here. And on the bottom, you see also the most relevant documents for this particular team. So that's just what I used as input to create those folders. And see if the recommendation engine is able to generate useful recommendations based on these teams. So when I press this button, it gets the folders that I created. I named them based on the team, and the documents that are inside are the documents that the experts saved for each team. For example, human trafficking. Now I can just press the button here and export whatever I stored in that folder. And here are the documents that are related to the team human trafficking. And when I press recommend, it will generate interesting recommendations based on these documents that are in the folder. And actually it makes sense because human trafficking is very much related to prostitution. And that's, for example, what we see back here in a lot of those queries. So that's where I'd like to end this demonstration for the recommendation engine.
So with that, I can conclude, okay, we have a demo, it works. We have learned our lessons, we just started. I'd like to continue this with them with an English set of content with better logging. I also like to work on improving the quality in terms of normalizing the queries a bit better and adding more signals. And also very much improve the techniques in order to test this and to verify that it works. And with that, thank you very much, and I'll leave some room for questions.
Fantastic, thank you, Tom. So, do we have any questions from the audience for Tom?
You have the historical clicks from your search, correct? So I was wondering why you didn't take, let's say, the last 1 year, the first 11 months, train your recommendation, and then predict the last 1 month clicks. And then you could measure map at K, and that was how usually people, how they evaluate their recommendation systems offline?
Yes, so I'm open for all kinds of suggestions. So this may be a good one. But there was no training involved here. So it's not that we have a model here that is going to be trained. This is really statistical information that we use a search engine for. Let's have a discussion afterwards to see how we can actually do this. It's indeed true, I believe, that if you look back at the whole year history, that the last actions are much more important than the first ones. So in the initial way of how we did it, we just took information from a whole year where it doesn't matter where the action happened. But yes, you're true. We should actually apply some, to improve this, apply some weighting where we can somehow boost the last actions much, much harder than the first actions. Yep.
Keeps you fit, this hosting business.
I sat all the way up here just so I could watch Charlie do that. I'm just going to throw out a thought here. When I'm always looking at how to improve search for different situations, I always go back to a simple analogy. A person walking into a library looking for something, and they're going to talk to a librarian. And so search at its best really is a conversation, right? It's a back and forth. A librarian, if I walked in and said, oh, I'm looking for XYZ, they're not going to be like, well, XYZ is on the second shelf on the left, third over. They're going to actually give questions back to me to make sure that what I'm looking for, I really actually need, right? Because it could be that I'm misinformed and maybe I want something else. So it's a conversation, I think, at its best. And in the example you're giving, which is a knowledge domain where people are not just looking for documents, they're looking to probably understand the domain, I would think that part of what may be very valuable here is actually having a topic model, because part of what they're looking for is understanding the knowledge space, right? And that's partly what you're seeing in your responses and in your content. So for a user who's coming into a new topic and maybe knows nothing about it, like miniature plungers, as Charlie illustrated yesterday, maybe I want to understand all the concepts around that space, right? So it's not just that I want documents back, but I actually want to also understand the knowledge space, which is really a topic model. Just food for thought.
All right, thanks for feedback.
Okay, so we have a question from our online group. So Ben Egan asks, do you have any advice about monitoring the success of personalization? How do you spot and measure the badness for a single user with peculiar tastes?
How do you respond to the badness? Can you please repeat that last question?
Okay, so I'll read it again. So do you have any advice about monitoring the success of personalization? And how do you spot and measure the badness for a single user with peculiar tastes? Ben, if you want to try and restate the question on the Zoom chat, maybe we can see the
Yeah, well, at least the first part, that's the slide that I said, it's going to be hard to test, verify the success. I think we need to be careful not to use the recommendations as directly as a filter or as a way to boost in the first place, unless we are very sure that for certain percentage it really works. So I would rather be a bit conservative in applying this in the first place, maybe just in a way where it harms less, like part of autocomplete, you can just simply ignore it, or maybe as a separate set of suggestions next to the search results where you can monitor how much users actually use it and click on it. And if this amount grows, then you can make more certain case that, okay, in those cases, maybe we can actually apply it in a different way rather than just suggesting it.
Thank you.
In terms of trying to measure the success or failure, do you think like team draft interleaving of the results, like in an autocomplete, might give you the information to say people like the personalized recommendations more than the other recommendation, other autocomplete suggestions? Would that be the way to get more confidence?
Yeah, so that's what I've just said. I think if you interleave it with autocomplete suggestions, which are already there, like we saw in the Google example, it's clearly also interleaved there. So I like to do this and then also measure how much often user actually use it. And that would be a very good indication that we're doing the right thing. It will also be slow because we have to capture this information. It takes some time. Online looping is always takes some time. But let's. I think that is the most safe way in order to really have a good understanding whether recommendations work or not. Yeah.
Okay, so Ben clarified his question online. He's talking, he said, I'm trying to highlight how much more complex monitoring in production becomes when every user's case is different. Yeah. So I'm curious if user grain tracking is the only option.
Yeah, so we really want to do also some find some way of offline testing. But in our case, we don't have the luxury of a lot of traffic in our products. So we have not millions of users, but rather thousands. And most of them are not so active, as I saw. So online testing only helps us a little bit. So we really have to also find ways in order to do offline testing. And it's going to be a critical part of this whole success, whether we are able to test this or not. And it's going to be, like I said before, it's a difficult thing. I think we need to approach it from multiple angles. There's not just one golden way of testing it.
Great, thank you. Do we have any more questions? Just there's one here. Excuse me.
Hi, thanks so much. I noticed that in the recommended queries that came back, the first three were the last three queries that the person had given. And I was wondering if, you know, in presentation you would clean that up. And then the other thing that I thought was maybe a user, you know, is there a way to offer a user the option to clear what they had, you know, like specifically like one of those queries or all of them?
Yeah, that's a good one. I knew it was part of it. They are actually anomalies returning inside the similar recommendation, similar sessions. Yes, I think in production they should be left out because it doesn't make sense to recommend the same things that are already being entered. I left them in here on purpose just to make the case that those are also anomalies. And they are, there's a very clear example that those anomalies are actually, it's not surprising that they actually come back as one of the, on the top recommendations. But yes, they should be cleared out. Also, I believe that there should be a way to for the user to opt out from getting recommendations or to just erase everything from the past and start from a clean sheet as well. Yeah, because I think, that just makes sense. And if the user is aware about where the recommendations are based from, I think that should be part of the feedback, that it is based on maybe last actions, the last session, the last year, whatever we take as an input. The user should be able to have influence on this and maybe like have such a box like we have on the screen here to modify the past as well.
Okay, I think we had one more question here. Sorry.
Great talk. Just quick question. You had shown user profiles as part of the recommendation system, and I was curious from operational standpoint, how are you generating them? How often are you refreshing them? Do you do that live, you know, while person's in session? Just a little more detail on that side.
It's a good question. We haven't done this in this POC. This was kind of a static operation. We just got a sample set from 2021 and just took that. But there was no refreshing yet. It was just kind of static and didn't change. In reality, yes, we need to refresh it. So now, how often is that okay? So I think for a year-based, it shouldn't have to be done every year, I think, of every day. Maybe every month makes sense to do so. And also I think that we should also go to this weighted history, like this gentleman said. That we should actually look at the last month as a very important piece of data and just what happens 9 months ago is not so relevant anymore. Maybe we should keep it, but give it a lower score. The refresh rate, yes. Once a week, once a month, was thinking about that. Depends a bit on the case, I guess.
Okay, so I think we'll leave it there. Thank you very much, Tom.
All right.
And please, Tom Bergmans.
Thank you very much.